So welcome everybody for this. This is the last of the student seminar of this year. So I guess in September it's going to start again, but for the moment it's going to be the last. It's going to be the turn of Victor, that he's going to talk about this measuring with a task that I don't know what it is, but he will say implication and applications. So
thank you very much. And thank you everybody for coming. Good afternoon. And for those of you who don't know me, well, I'm Victor. I'm doing my PhD in experimental nuclear physics here at IFIC. Yes, I'm going to talk about measurements with task detectors. And well, this is the outline of my talk. First of all, I will introduce the motivation of the measurements with these kind of detectors. Then I will explain the technique we use. And in particular, I will focus on the D-task detector. That is the one I've been using in my PhD. Then I will say a few words about the first experiments with this detector that we performed a couple of years ago in Finland. And then I will try to explain step by step how we proceed with the analysis of this kind of measurements. So first of all, the idea of what kind of things are we interested in. So we are measuring beta decay. So I assume that most of you have studied at some point of your lives nuclear physics, and you are familiar with this nuclear chart. And you know that each of the lines of this nuclear chart are the equivalent of each of the elements in the periodic table. So here we have all the nuclei ordered by the number of protons versus the number of neutrons. And each of these lines correspond to each of the atomic elements. And the different nuclei are the different isotopes. So if we go to neutron-rich nuclei, so to the right, we have a nuclei with an excess of neutrons, and the tendency of this nuclei is to convert a neutron into a proton in order to go back to these black dots that are the stable ones. So this is what we call the valley of stability, the stable nuclei. And all the other guys are unstable nuclei that are trying to go back to this valley. So one process is this beta minus that happens in this region, and the other one is the beta plus that happens in the proton-rich, or better say the neutron deficient region, where we have nuclei with less neutrons than the stable, than the corresponding stable one. So the tendency is to convert one proton into a neutron to go back to the valley of stability. And of course we have many other processes, for example alpha decay in heavier nuclei, but I am just interested in the beta decay, and the electron capture, which is a process that competes with beta plus, and which basically is the capture of an electron by the proton. And since electrons are surrounding the nucleus, this is a process that competes with this beta plus in this neutron deficient site. So the idea is that we are going to perform measurements of beta decay. So this is just an example to fix which are the interesting quantities for us in experimental nuclear physics. Here we have a calibration source. This is the sodium-24 that decays by means of beta minus into magnesium. And in between, we are populating different levels. So the idea is that this transition doesn't go directly in general to the ground state, so to the zero energy of the daughter nucleus, but populates excited states. And the idea is that these excited states de-excite by means of gamma rays. So what we have to keep in mind is that in beta decay experiments, we are going to measure the beta, so the electron or the positron, are gammas in general. Of course, if we are going farther from the stability, we also have the emission of neutrons and the emission of protons. But in general, these are the two things that we are going to measure. This value here, this Q value, is the energy, the difference in energy between the ground state of the daughter and the ground state of the parent. And this is the energy window in which we can populate levels in the daughter nucleus. And these numbers, which are the key of my talk, are the beta intensity distribution. So the probability of populating one of these excited states coming from the parent. So the probability to go to one of these excited levels from the ground state of the parent. And these numbers in blue are just the gamma intensities of these gamma rays that are de-exciting the dot. So this is the, so to say, the main idea, just to keep in mind the values we are using. And from the point of view of theory, Fermi in the 30s did the formulation, the mathematical formulation of the beta decay. Well, we distinguish two modes of beta decay, the Fermi and the gamma stellar. And the idea is that we are trying to connect this theory with what we can measure experimentally with observables. And for this, we use, as always in quantum mechanics, transition probabilities. And in the particular case of the gamma delta transitions that are the most common in nuclear physics and the ones we are interested in, these two operators are in between the initial and the final states. This is the tau operator, which is basically the operator related to the isospin, and the sigma operator related to the spin. So between these two initial and final states, we have the gamma delta operator, and this is the probability to connect these two levels. And the idea is that the connection of this probability with what we can measure experimentally is given by this expression. This is proportional to the intensity distribution, so these numbers that I was saying that are very important, the Fermi function and the difference in energy between the Q value and the excited states in the daughter, so the difference between this number and this number, and the half-life. So ideally what one should do is to measure this intensity distribution, this difference in energy, this Q value and this energy, and the half-life. In particular, the kind of experiments we perform are focused on this measurement, the intensity distribution. So how can we measure these values? Well, traditionally, this measurement is done with germanium detectors. Germanium detectors are high-resolution detectors, are semiconductor detectors. And here I put a couple of pictures just to imagine how they are. This is a germanium detector that we have in our laboratory here at IFIC. And this is an array of several germanium detectors that are useful to do coincidences and these kinds of things. And the idea is that with these detectors, we can calculate this intensity distribution just by checking the intensities of the gamma peaks we see in our detector. So doing an intensity balance. For example, here I have a toy level scheme with just two levels and two gamma rays. And we see two peaks with the same intensity. So the idea is that one should extract from these intensities the feeling, and one should say that the intensity distribution is populating 100% this level and 0% this one, because otherwise this gamma should have a higher intensity. This is nice, as far as you don't miss any gamma ray. But we know that germanium detectors, they are high resolution detectors, but they have a moderate efficiency. And the chances that we miss one of these gamma rays are high when we have a cascade of multiple gammas. And this happens and was identified in the 70s by Hardy and collaborators, and it's what we call the pandemonium effect, which sounds like something like a mess. It means that if we miss one of these gammas in the cascade of the de-excitation, we assign a wrong feeling to the levels. And we would say that this level has 100% probability to be populated, whereas this one has 0%, and we know that this is the other way around. So how can we overcome this problem? So we have to face this idea of measuring the beta intensity distribution with other technique. And this is the TAS technique. And the TAS technique is basically the opposite. Instead of having a high resolution detector with low efficiency, we have a high efficiency detector with low resolution. And the idea is that instead of detecting individual gamma rays, what we detect is the full gamma cascade. So instead of having two peaks, and as in the previous case, what we have is the sum of these two gammas, so a sum peak. And the idea is that for this, we need to maximize the efficiency of our detector, and that's why we design detectors large with normally scintillator crystals, trying to cover the full solid angle, so that we maximize this detection efficiency. Now the question is, okay, we have these other kinds of measurements, but how do we extract the intensity distribution from this? Because this is not just the intensity balance. And for this, we need to do a deconvolution. And we have to solve this inverse problem. And I would like to explain each of the quantities. So this is the experimental spectrum, what we measure. This is the feeding distribution. In other words, the intensity, the beta intensity distribution, what we want to calculate. And in between, we have the response matrix of the detector. We have to think that I are the experimental channels and J are the levels. So these levels that we have in the source, the probability to populate each of these levels. So the idea is that what connects these two quantities is the response matrix of our detector, which is something unique and something that we calculate with Monte Carlo simulations, as I will show later. And this response matrix is not only unique for its detector, but also for its decay scheme, because it also depends on the branching ratio matrix. This branching ratio matrix is nothing but the intensities and how these gammas are connecting the different states. These gamma intensities that was mentioned at the beginning, so the branching ratio is related to this. So we have to do a deconvolution. And this deconvolution is done with an expectation maximization method based on bias, the bias theory. If we go to this formula and we try to calculate only the fittings, we have to pass this matrix with the inverse to the other side, and we have basically this equation. And this is the probability of having a fitting to level J that is producing a count in our experimental spectrum in the channel I. And this is something that we cannot calculate, because we cannot say if a count in our spectrum is coming from fitting to level 1, 2, or 3. But thanks to Bayes' theorem, that is nothing but the conditional probability, we know that this probability is proportional to the probability of given a fitting to a level, the probability to have a count in an experimental spectrum. And this we can calculate with Monte Carlo simulations, because it's just having fitting to one level and see how it translates into an experimental spectrum. And it's proportional to this probability times the probability in general of having fitting to this level, which is basically this intensity distribution we are interested in. And this is the problem, because this intensity distribution is also in the solution of our algorithm. And that's why we have to do it iteratively. We have to assume an initial distribution, normally a flat distribution, and we have to calculate several iterations of this algorithm, and the output of this algorithm is going back to the formula. How can we estimate the convergence of this algorithm? Well, we go back to this equation, and the fitting distribution we obtain is multiplied by the response function, and we calculate the difference with respect to the experimental spectrum. If they are close enough, they are converging, so we have a result of our analysis. So this is the mathematical expression of the Bayes theorem that we use in this algorithm. So the idea now is, this is how we analyze these kinds of experiments, but we need detectors that fulfill all the requirements I was mentioning at the beginning related to efficiency and so on. And in particular, in the gamma spectroscopy group, we are very keen to do this kind of measurements. And in particular, now we have currently three detectors working with this technique. One is at CERN, it's Lucrezia, that is a monocrystal made of sodium iodide. And this is a permanent setup at El Sole. And this is Rocinante, that is a barium fluoride detector that is segmented in 12 different detectors, that is now in our laboratory. And we have used this detector in several measurements in Finland. And these two detectors are this kind of spectrometers, this TAS that I was explaining. And the other one is the DITAS I was especially interested in. That is the newest one. It's also a segmented spectrometer. It's made of up to 18 crystals, also sodium iodide crystals as Lucrezia. And they are 15 times 15 times 25 centimeters. So they are really big crystals, each of them for around 20 kilograms. And the individual crystal resolution is around 7-8% at around 600 kV. So to give you an idea, a germanium detector, that is high resolution detector, is around of the order of 1% at these energies. So this is the difference. But the other difference is the efficiency. This detector has a 80-90% efficiency depending on the energy. And this is nice because this efficiency for one gamma. If you have a cascade of several gammas, you have to multiply 90% times 90% times 90%. In the end, your gamma cascade is detected with almost 100% efficiency. The good thing of this detector is that since it is modular, you can place the different detectors in different configurations. In particular, we have two in the 16 and the 18 detector configuration. The 16 is this one with the hole in the middle. And the idea is that we need a hole to place inside the beam pipe where we are going to drive the nuclei and to put other detectors, ancillary detectors to make coincidences or whatever. And this is the 18 detector configuration with a hole in the middle. We separate the crystals and we enter with the beam pipe or with another detector to the center of the detector. And this is the configuration that I have used in particular in my analysis. So the idea of this detector, that as I mentioned is the newest one we have designed, is that it is going to be used at FAIR. FAIR is a future project that will be in the current facility of GSI. And this is a long traditional facility in Europe, in Germany, that produces radioactive beams. And the idea is that in the future, we don't know exactly when, we will have available a new accelerator and a new fragment separator. And in particular, the DITAS will be an instrument that we plan to use in the low energy bands. So this detector was designed for this facility, but in the meanwhile, we have used it in other places, and we plan to use it in other places. In particular, we used it 2 years ago in Finland. So we bring our detector here at IFI, and we went to Finland. We moved almost 2 tons of equipment by truck to Finland, and we performed a campaign of experiments in the middle of the winter in Finland. The idea of these experiments was to measure uranium fission fragments. And why uranium fission fragments? Well, these nuclei are interesting because several reasons. First of all, because we have uranium fission fragments in nuclear plants, and it is interesting to know them as well as possible. The second thing is that they are neutron-rich nuclei, and we have beta minus decay, which is the thing we are studying. And the second thing is that, in general, if they are far from stability, many of them are, they have a big Q value. So this difference in energy I was mentioning is very large, and in theory, the level density and the number of gammas in the de-excitation is also very high. So you expect that you miss one of these gammas in normal traditional experiments, so that they are supposed to be affected by pandemonium. So they are candidates to be pandemonium affected. And the motivations that I will explain in detail later, well, are reactor technology, neutrino physics, and also beta delay neutron emission. So this is the layout of the facility. Here in Jyväskylä, they have two accelerators, actually. One of them is the old one, it's a cyclotron that we were using, that is over there. And we have protons from this accelerator that were driven to the proton fission ion guide, where we had a natural uranium target, and these protons were driven to this uranium target, and the fragments of this uranium were separated in the mass separator with the magnet. So they were separated in mass. For us, the mass is the sum of neutrons and protons. So a nucleus with mass 100 means that you can have 50 protons and 50 neutrons, or 40 protons and 60 neutrons, whatever. But this is mass. The question is that if you want to distinguish also the particular nucleus you are interested in, you need another system to purify the beam. And in this particular case, at IGISOL, they have a double Penick trap system that is a Penick trap where you can insert the ions, and you select the frequency of the movement inside the trap, and you extract only the ions with this frequency. And this is a way to clean the beams. And afterwards, we had the DITAS detector, and we were implanting these bunches of nuclei in the middle of the detector. In particular, they were implanted on a tape. And this tape is something very tricky, because you have to implant in the center of the DITAS, and then you have to remove the activity in order not to contaminate your detector. So this is a tape system that is moving all the time in cycles that basically depend on the half-life of the nucleus you are measuring. So this is from the point of view of the facility, from the point of view of our detectors. This is how the setup looked like. Here is the DITAS detector. You can see it is surrounded by shielding made of stainless steel and lead and aluminum. And well, this shielding is just to reduce the background radiation we have in normal conditions, environmental background. We also had scintillator plastic detectors in the middle to make coincidences between the gammas that are measured by the DITAS and the betas measured by this. If you remember at the beginning, I told you that in general we are interested in measuring betas and gammas. So these are the detectors to measure these betas, and the DITAS is the one to measure the gammas. And we also had in our setup Liemannian detectors to just check the contamination of possible other nuclei that were in our setup. Since it is a high resolution detector, we can see different lines and see if we have contamination coming from other nuclei or from the radioactive chain we are measuring. So this is in general the setup. We did these measurements, and now I want to explain step by step how we proceed to the analysis of these measurements. And the first thing we have to do is to calculate, if you remember, this response matrix, because this is the key of our analysis. We have calculated this D, so this D was the experimental spectrum, it's calculated, we measured it, and now we have to calculate the response matrix in order to extract this film distribution. And this response matrix, as I advance when I talk about the bias theory, is calculated by means of Monte Carlo simulations. But the idea is that we use Monte Carlo simulations to reproduce the calibration sources. So we use calibration sources that are well-known decays in order to reproduce them, and once we can validate the Monte Carlo response, we can calculate the response for unknown nuclei. So the idea is that we use calibration sources, but we have first to clean these measurements, and for this we have to reject the background. And this is an example of a cobalt source. This is a normal source that we have at the laboratory, and this is the background measurement, so we have to just eliminate this background. We normalize it just by the time of the measurement. And we have our cobalt source. And for those of you who are familiar with this, you know that the cobalt has two peaks, and these are these two peaks, and this is the total absorption peak, because these are two gammas that de-excite in a cascade, but in our detector, they are, in almost all the events, they are some. But we also have these other funny peaks, and these peaks are just an electronic distortion that is what we call the pileup. That in the particular case of a segmented spectrometer, we also have the effect of the summing. And this summing and this pileup have to be also calculated, because we need to also subtract this contamination. And for this, we use a kind of Monte Carlo sampling code that basically what is taking into account is the event structure we have measured. So the idea is that if we have one event that is a physical event in our ADC, but we have another event that is coming to our ADC very close to the first one, we can register both of them in the same event for the ADC. And this is a problem because we cannot distinguish what physically was distinguished. And for example, if we have two signals in the same crystal, for example in crystal 2, and they arrive at the same time for our ADC, even though they come from different physical events, we have a pileup. Maybe you know that is a pileup, which is the composition of these two pulses, and this is distorting the maximum of the signal, that is what your ADC normally is registering. But also, if you have a signal, for example, in detector 3, and a signal in detector 4, in two different events, but you are registering both events in the same ADC event, it is as if you had a signal in detector 3 and 4 at the same time, and this is the summing. And you have to evaluate all these things for the 18 detectors, sum everything, and this is your summing pileup contribution that you have to normalize properly and so on. But the idea is that in order to reconstruct this, we just sampling Monte Carlo are able to reproduce this contamination. And here you have the result for this particular case. So we can reproduce all these funny peaks that are just coming from the distortion, the electronic distortion that is introduced in our ADC. Furthermore, we also need an energy calibration, because we need to consider the reference peaks of the calibration sources in order to calibrate in energy. This is normal, and we need a width calibration for our Monte Carlo. Width calibration is a calibration of the width of the peaks, because for the Monte Carlo we need to widen the peaks of the Monte Carlo in order to compare. So the next step is to introduce all our information about geometry and physics inside Monte Carlo code. And for this we use JAM4, and in JAM4 we define our geometry with all details possible. Here I have several cuts of the Monte Carlo I am using, and we have the geometry of all our detectors, the beam pipe, the plastic detector, the germanium detector, the ceiling surrounding the detector, everything. We have to take into account the physics, and when I say the physics is the processes that happens in our detector, in particular the absorption of the photons, the electrons, the different ranges of this absorption. In the particular case of the sodium anodide, you have a non-proportionality in the production of light, because this is a scintillator crystal, and this production of light is non-proportional with the energy, all these things. And then you have to simulate the source itself, and the source itself is simulated with an event generator or with the radioactive decay that is inside JAM4. And with this, we simulate and we obtain, when we take into account the contamination of the pileup, we have the reproduction, a nice reproduction of the source. And when we get this, that you see that in energy is perfectly aligned and in width is perfectly defined, we can say that we have validated our response with a calibration source. For sure, we need to use it with different calibration sources, not only with one. For example, this is another example of sodium 22, another source. We can reproduce it perfectly, also the pileup, and we can take advantage of the segmentation of our detector to check if we are also capable to reproduce the different multiplicities. And when I say multiplicity, for example, multiplicity 1 is all those events when we have a count in one of the 18 detectors. This is multiplicity 1. Multiplicity 2 is we have two detectors firing, whichever detector, but two. Multiplicity 2, multiplicity 3, multiplicity 4, and if we are able to reproduce all these multiplicities, it means that our response is working well, our geometry, our physics, everything is in principle correct, our calibrations and so on. So once we have validated our geometry, we can calculate the response function. And now I'm going to explain it with an example, a physical example. This is one of the measurements we did in Juvascula. It's the beta minus decay of this branch of the double beta decay system of mass 100. So the decay of the 100 technetium into 100 ruthenium. And this is a double beta decay system, and it is quite interesting because the double beta decay is from molybdenum to ruthenium, but the idea is that in theoretical calculations, many times you use the information coming from the individual branches, the electron capture and the beta minus branch, in order to check your calculations. So for theorists, this is very important to know these two branches with accurate tools, as in the case of the TAS technique. So that's why we measure this decay. These are the experimental measurements. In blue we have the raw measurement coming from the betas, and this is when we put a coincidence with the beta. Of course, if we have a coincidence between the gamma and the beta, we are basically eliminating almost all the background. And we have to calculate again all the contaminants. In this case, we have to calculate again the Samin pileup. We have to take into account the background because in this particular case we have random coincidences between the betas and the background, and we also take it into account. And the question is that with this input information, we proceed to calculate the response function. And the response function, as I mentioned, depends on the branching ratio matrix. And the branching ratio matrix depends on the level scheme you are using and the de-excitation pattern of the daughter nucleus. And this is the particular case of the 100 technetium. It has a Q value of 3.2 MeV, and these are all the levels that are known in beta decay, and these are the intensities that were known from a previous high resolution experiments, and these are the energies of the levels. So in order to construct this response function, we need to simulate first the betas, and the betas are calculated by taking into account the Q value and the energy of the levels, and these are the betas. The energy of the beta is just the difference between the Q value and the energy of the level. And this is the responses for this beta part. This is the response of the ground state, which is the largest one, because it's the difference in energy between these two levels, so all the Q value. And these are the responses going up to these levels at high energies. And this is the beta part. And it's worth mentioning that in this particular case, I'm showing you as an example, we only have this known part. Later I will explain what happens in a more complex case. Then we have to calculate the gamma part, and the gamma part is calculated with all the gammas with the corresponding intensities for the different gamma cascades between the different levels. So we calculate all the gammas, we simulate all the different gammas for all the transitions. And afterwards we combine these two things, the beta part and the gamma part, and we have the response matrix, this R matrix, that is basically the response of our detector to feeding to one of these levels, to feeding to level 60, to level 40, to level, we have, this is the response, how our detector would react if we had a count in one of these levels. And with this, we go directly to the Bayes formula, and we obtain the intensity, the beta intensity distribution, so these probabilities. And we can compare with the previous results, and we see that for this particular case, they are almost the same that were known before, except of this level at high energies that it was not seen before, and in principle is compatible with our analysis. And this is the experimental spectrum is here in gray, and in black we have this intensity distribution multiplied by this response matrix. So it gives you an idea of the quality of our analysis, because we are reproducing very well the experimental spectrum, just by multiplying this intensity by the response matrix, which was the first formula I showed you. So here, these are the results for this case that, as I told you, is very simple. what happens in a more complex case? So in other cases that we cannot trust all the information that is known, we have to distinguish two parts. We have to distinguish the experimentally known part, that is what I have used in the previous example, and we have to select another part, that is what we call the continuum part, that goes from this point up to we trust the known experimental part to the Q value. And this part here, for example, I have the level density, so the number of levels with energy, how it's increasing, and in blue is the experimental, and in black is the theoretical. So up to this red line, we trust, so to say, the experimental part, because we have seen from literature that it makes sense that we have this number of levels, but from this point onward, we don't trust the known information, and we calculate a continuum based on the statistical model. And this statistical model uses this level density distribution and uses the photon strength function parameters in order to calculate how we connect all these levels that we are creating here, how we connect between them, and how we connect these levels with the known part. So this is, so to say, a second part of this response matrix that is more complex and involves different parameters that are quite complex. And I don't want to bore you with all these details, but the question is that in normal cases we have to do this procedure in two parts, and this part is the trickiest one. So related to applications, applications with real cases, the first thing we can do with these kinds of measurements, for example, is to apply it to calculations with a nuclear reactor, because as I mentioned, in a nuclear reactor we have also fission fragments, and these fission fragments many times are not well known. And it is important to know them well, because we want to design reactors and we want to manipulate them safely, and we want to evaluate the shielding we need to use, and we need to manage the nuclear waste products safely, and for this we need information about the nuclei that are involved in our reactor. And there is something that is called the decay heat, and the decay heat is nothing but the energy released by the nuclear products that are radioactive, because once you have the fission, you obtain the fission products, but these fission products are also radioactive, and they are also emitting energy that you cannot control, because this is the beta decay, the natural beta decay of this nuclei. And in order to calculate it, traditionally, people are using this summation calculation method, that is basically the decay heat, how it evolves in the time, related to the different nuclear species that are in our reactor. And in the middle, you have the mean beta energy, the mean gamma energy, and the mean alpha energy of these nuclei. And you have the number of nuclei for each of the species. So the idea is that these mean quantities, this mean beta energy and this mean gamma energy, are closely related to this intensity distribution that we are calculating from our analysis. So this mean gamma energy and this mean beta energy can be directly calculated with the results of our analysis. And we have observed in the past that if we have pandemonium, if one of these fission products suffers from pandemonium, the mean beta energy is overestimated, because you can figure more or less how it works, because we are thinking that we connect with levels at lowest energy, that they are in reality, and the mean gamma energy is underestimated, because we think that we are connecting with levels at lowest, at lower energies. So this problem was identified, and now the International Nuclear Energy Agency is promoting these kinds of measurements with TAS in order to calculate these intensity distributions free from this systematic error. And in particular, it was the result of one of the previous thesis in my group for the case of several fission products that give rise to an improvement in the description of this decay heat profile, in this particular case for the 239 plutonium. And you can see how with the TAS data coming from this previous work, you improved a lot this calculation. And the experiment we did in Juvascula, we also measured a couple of nuclei related to the decay heat problem, and we measured the 103 technetium and the 103 molybdenum. They are involved in this decay heat problem, and actually they are priority one nuclei for this calculation, so they are very important. And this is the decay chain we have the molybdenum going by metal decay to technetium that goes to ruthenium, that for all practical purposes for us is stable. The question is that here you see why this Penick trap that I was mentioning is useful, because here we have mass 103 in our case is made of three different nuclei. If we have a Penick trap, this is the Penick trap mass scan, we can select the frequency of one of these three guys in order to implant in our setup only this nucleus and not the other two. Of course, if we implant molybdenum, we will have also technetium because it's the daughter. But you can reject the other two in principle. So this is why the Penick trap is so useful. And these are the results, for example, for the 103 technetium. We again reproduce very well the experimental spectrum, and we detect a new intensity at high energies close to the Q value that wasn't detected before. Here again, I'm comparing our results with the results. This is the database that we normally use, where the measurements of high resolution are implemented, and we see in green more or less the same intensities, but here the previous experiments didn't have any signal. In the case of the 103 molybdenum, there is no evaluation for the intensity, so everything is, so to say, new, and we had to take into account the contamination of the daughter. And again, the match between experiment and what we reconstruct with our response matrix and our feeding distribution is very nice. There is another application of this kind of data that is closely related to the decay heat, that is the antineutrino spectrum calculation. Because if you can calculate with this summation calculation method the decay heat, you can also use the same principle to calculate the antineutrino spectrum coming from a reactor. And it's quite interesting, for example, in the case of the neutrino oscillation experiments, because they many times use reactor antineutrinos and they put a closed detector in order to check the beam at the beginning, and they compare, or even they calculate the spectrum of the antineutrino coming from the reactor at this point with the information available in the databases. If this information is not correct, this spectrum doesn't match the experimental one, or is not the appropriate one. So again, we have the same principle, and this branching ratio that is multiplying the individual neutrino spectrum. Here you have the individual neutrino spectrum that corresponds to each of the fission products, and it is multiplied by the intensity, the beta intensity distribution that is here in this branching ratio, that is going to each of the levels. So with this formula, you can calculate extensively this antineutrino spectrum. But if these branching ratios are not correct, your neutrino spectrum is not the correct one. And from the point of view of task measurements, in the past we have performed one measurement in the previous experiments that was a very important nucleus for the antineutrino reactor spectrum, maybe the most important. And in the past campaign with the DDAS, we have measured another two nuclei that are also very important. Here I show you a piece of the work of our collaborator Alejandro Sonsoni, and we have this total antineutrino spectrum in this region of energy and for the uranium-235, and we have highlighted in color the main contributors. And here you have in green is this 92 rubidium that I mentioned that is the most important. And here I have the two ones we have measured. This one in green and another one in pink here, that is the 140 cesium. And this is more or less the idea. You are summing all this contribution for all the individual antineutrino spectrum, and you get the total one. And the total one here is compared with experiment, and the question is that there is a discrepancy at high energies. And now everybody is trying to measure the most important contributors to this tail here, because there is a disagreement that is quite important at the level of precision they are using in these experiments. So this is an example of one of these two cases we measured, the case of the 100 niobium. The 100 niobium has the peculiarity that it has two isomeric states, so the zirconium populates the low spin isomer, but there is also another niobium, so to say, because it has a half-life comparable to the ground state, that is at almost half MeV of this ground state, that in principle is assumed to be F5 plus. So in reality here we have two nuclei. So it's the same at the level of structure, but the decay of this guy is going from the from these two levels, not only from the ground state. And well, we managed to measure both isomers, and again we have new intensity that was not detected before, and again we have a very nice reproduction of the experiment with our response and our feeding distribution, and the same for the high spin isomer. For the other one, we also have a very nice reproduction and we have new intensity. So this is just to show you how this kind of information that at first glance is very simple, it's just the intensity, can be used for different applications. Now the people that are calculating this antineutrino business will get this information and will re-evaluate the antineutrino spectrum in order to see possible discrepancies with the previous calculations. And the last applications I want to show you is the case of the beta delay neutron emission. The beta delay neutron emission is a process that happens when the neutron separation energy of the daughter nucleus is below the Q value, so inside the Q value window, so that we can populate excited levels in the nucleus that de-excite by means of the emission of a neutron instead of just emitting gamma rays. And this is quite interesting because here we have a competition between the emission of neutrons that should be dominant because it's ruled by a strong interaction, and the electromagnetic de-excitation that is in principle slower. However, you have to think that in order to populate these levels here by the emission of neutrons, you have to be able to connect them from these excited states. And for this, it is a question of spin and parity and angular momentum of the neutrons that are emitted. So it is not so easy. And we have seen recently that this information coming from the beta decay is also interesting from the point of view of astrophysics, because this competition between neutrons going here and gammas going from the same levels is closely related to the N-gamma cross-sections in astrophysics, and it also is also interesting from the point of view of the nuclear structure for this gamma-neutron competition. The bad thing for us is that, as I mentioned at the beginning, we want to measure betas, we want to measure gammas, but we are not, strictly speaking, prepared to measure neutrons because we don't have a neutron detector. However, our detector, fortunately or unfortunately, detects the neutrons because neutrons also interact with our detector. And I will show a couple of cases that we also measure. This is the 137 iodine, and the 137 iodine has the neutron separation energy of the xenon. You see that it's 4 MeV, while the Q value is 6 MeV. So we have 2 MeV window when this competition is possible. And the question is that in this case, everything is easier because the neutrons are populating only the ground state of the daughter, this xenon 136. But the question is that we have to calculate the contamination coming from the neutrons, and this contamination, since we are not measuring neutrons individually, we have to simulate it. And for this, we need to know, a priori, the neutron spectrum that is interacting with our detector. And with this, and playing with our simulations, we can reproduce the neutron interaction with the detector, that is here in light blue. And in particular, we see this peak, that is the neutron capture peak in the crystal itself of our detector. In fact, in the iodine. So the neutrons are slow down and they are captured in the iodine of our crystal, and this capture gives rise to a gamma cascade that is around 7 MeV, and this is something that we see in our detector. So we have to be able to calculate this contamination that is also subtracted, and we evaluate also the pile up and the daughter activity, and after taking into account all these things we obtain the intensity distribution. Here we have also intensity going with neutrons, that was not in the previous cases as I saw you, and again the reproduction is very nice, and in between these two lines we have the region where we have gammas, all these gammas here, that are competing with the emission of neutrons, just because nuclear structure. The same thing happens with the 95 rubidium. In the 95 rubidium, this window for the competition is even larger because we have almost 5 MeV between the neutron separation energy and the Q value, and in this case we also have the contamination of the daughter and the granddaughter because both are radioactive and have comparable half-life. And what's more, we have a population of excited states in the daughter. So we also have not only neutrons but also the gammas in the de-excitation of this nucleus. So we again evaluate the contamination of the neutrons, the contamination of the daughter, the contamination of the granddaughter, the pileup, everything, and we extract the feeding distribution, the intensity distribution that we were looking for. And we compare with the experimental spectrum and we see a nice agreement. And again, all this intensity here, this intensity that goes by means of emission of gamma rays that should go, in theory, by means of neutrons. So this is just a picture of the kind of measurements we do and several applications with this. So just in summary, the TAS technique is a powerful tool in order to extract this beta intensity distribution when we are far from stability and we expect to suffer from this pandemonium systematic error. Our group in particular has a lot of experience in these kinds of measurements, and actually the people that work here have developed the algorithms and many tools to extract this information. And at the level of the nuclear physics community, it is a very huge effort. The DITA spectrometer is the last one they have developed, and it was successfully commissioned with radioactive beams 2 years ago, and now we are getting the first results. The idea is that this detector, as I explained, will be part of this FAIR collaboration at GSI in Germany, but in the meanwhile we are using it in different experiments. 2 years ago we did this in Finland. In the future we may measure with this detector in Orsay in Paris, and many other experiments that are upcoming. And finally, well, the information of this case of this kind of measurements, as you have seen, could be useful for specific applications, reactor technology, antineutrino physics, and the idea is that also the comparison with theoretical calculations is also important. I didn't show anything strictly related to this, but for example, the TAS data can bring information about, for example, the shape of the nuclei, whether they are spherical, oblate, prolate, just by comparing this intensity distribution calculated in other way with theoretical calculations. And this is nice because they can test nuclear models with experimental information, because normally, experimentally, we don't have access to all this information. And this is also nice to compare nuclear models. And that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
So, questions, comments?
One question regarding to this TAS detector: are much more expensive than the older, or is kind of easy to implement? Not easy, but
as far as I know, in comparison with the one that is at Isolde, that is a monocrystal, I think this one is cheaper, because a monocrystal is something very difficult to grow. If you want to grow a crystal with such a big dimension, it is difficult. It's better to grow smaller crystals, but I think it's something expensive, but not so expensive, for example, as the germanium arrays or something like this. Because if you heard about Agata or these kind of detectors that are made of germanium, these are very, very expensive. These detectors are not so expensive.
So this is to have many detectors, for other type of studies, no? Not in your case, but in the sense of in different research centers in the world to...
Yes, there are other centers with these kinds of detectors. Okay. Yes. And the question is that now is becoming more popular to have segmented detectors, because you get more information. Not only this intensity distribution, but also other things from these multiplicities that I didn't show for the particular cases of the nuclei, but you can get other information that is interesting. And it's nice because you can buy small detectors, and you can use them for a great variety of things, not only for a TAS. When you have a big crystal, you basically use it for a TAS, because you cannot do anything and you cannot move it.
Mm-hmm. And the other question is the doubt that when you make this pileup, mm-hmm. how robust is that the pileup is made, in the sense that, because you said that you have, when you compare with another experiment, you have one beam, one of the points that was higher with respect to previous measurement. In the sense, how robust is this pileup with respect with the, or how sure is the, that your data is correct at the end? Because you're subtracting, you subtract many stuff, and then you so remain with some.
In general, what we do in order to evaluate errors is to play with the normalization factor of the contaminants, and in particular the pileup, for example, we play changing the normalization factor 10%, 20%, depending. We have a theoretical expression to normalize the pileup. That in theory it works, and you see for all the cases that it is normalizing well the pileup. And this is just a question of probability. You have to compute all the combination of these 18 detectors, and you get a normalization factor, and you see by eye that it is normalized. But you can say, for example, that since it is in a very critical region, if you subtract a little bit more or less, your fit distribution may change. And that's why we change the normalization factor in order to evaluate the error. So our errors in general are very, very generous. So we play with these normalization factors to get error bars enough consistent with the systematics we have. And in general, it's not something that is out of control. It's something that you see, because if you subtract too much, you have negative counts and you have funny effects. So this is something you see. You can say if it is a 10% or 20% change, reasonable or not.
Which is the typical contribution of the pileup to your total spectrum?
You mean in the percent of?
Yes.
This is, it depends on the counting rate you have.
Okay. But to have a sick measurement, let's say, which is the one?
For example, in those measurements, normally the rate is very low and the pileup is less than 5% or something like this.
So you have an upper threshold, no?
Yes. But the question is not only the number of counts, but the shape of this pileup. This is the problem. Because normally it is going in the higher energy region,
which is the
most interesting for us.
Yeah, I imagine that for very, very neutron-rich nuclei, where you want to measure, because you will be interested in measuring also the gamma decay from the continuum, as you said.
Yes, so but
in this case, is very important.
For example, in this particular case, you see that here the pileup is in the region where we have the neutrons.
Yeah.
So the normalization here, we trust the theoretical calculation of the normalization factor that works for the other 15 nuclei I have checked. Mm-hmm. So it works for every nuclei, so we assume that it works for this one. And it is not something crazy. But you cannot see, because you don't have a region where the pileup is isolated. It's not as in other cases. For example, I don't know, here you have a region where you can compare, or even here you have pileup clearly, because here the only contaminant is the pileup. Here is the Q-value, and you cannot have anything above the Q-value. So everything here is the summing pileup. So of course, if you get a normalization that is reasonable, you see, okay, it makes sense, because I see that there is no other contaminant. But this is a very easy case, because this is the only contaminant. But if you go to more exotic nuclei, you get this kind of problem.
Is there other?
I have a question which maybe I should know, and it's very simple. What do you say is better to say neutral deficient than proton rich?
I know, this is a question of my way of mentioning things. No, for me, because you have the stable nuclei, mm-hmm. and for me, neutron rich is when you add neutrons, and neutral deficient is when you remove neutrons. But if you imagine,
it would be better to say neutron deficient than proton rich, because of
some. Of course, okay. But I am taking as a reference the I was trying to explain it from the point of view of the atomic physics and the periodic table, okay. And that's why I say for the same periodic table element, mm-hmm. you have a line with neutron rich and neutron deficient. So in this context, that's why I. But yes, you can say the other way around.
I have another question. Can you measure PM values directly from using this method?
In theory, yes, but technically it's very complex, because, for example, in this case, we have the Monte Carlo of the neutron, okay, and the normalization of this Monte Carlo is done with the PM value.
Ah, okay.
If you don't know the PM value, you normalize this neutron contribution just by checking the neutron capture peak, and this normalization factor is the PM.
Okay.
So in theory, yes. But technically, the neutron simulations have many, many complications.
Yeah.
And if you want me to calculate the PM value with this, I wouldn't trust it. But this particular simulation is done, the normalization is done with the PM value.
But if the PM value is known, already known, you can use it, no?
Here is used. Here is used the known value. Okay. And it normalized the contribution.
No, I was... So I mean, when I asked you, I meant if the PM value is not known.
If the PM value is not known, and you trust very well your simulations, the question is that now we are at the very beginning of these simulations because in this detector, this contribution is huge. In previous measurements with beta delay neutron emitters, this was not an issue. But here is an issue, and that's why we don't have under control our simulation. And we have to play in order to, so this is the other way around. We have to play with our simulations in order to normalize everything to the PM value. But if everything was very well controlled, and you normalize something that is unknown, the normalization factor is the PM value.
Yeah.
So if one day we control very well the simulations, I could say yes, we can calculate the PM value because this is just the normalization factor of the neutron contribution.
Because this is the same as the N gamma capture, no?
The neutron
capture.
The idea is that is the is yes.
It's the same process. I mean,
it's the same process in the sense that they are going in this branch with neutrons.
Yeah, so
yes.
Okay.
So the numbers, the global intensity going by neutrons is the PM value, is the PM value. So and actually these numbers here are normalized to the PM value, and all this intensity,
this was my other question.
And all this gamma intensity is normalized to 100 minus the PM value, because it's the intensity that should go by gamma, and the intensity that goes by neutrons is in blue here and is normalized to the PM value. So yes.
So at some point, you will be in degree of measuring PM value.
If we are really able to do it, yes. But there are other detectors designed to measure PM value.
Yeah, sure. But
if you have the
lens,
you don't use the NITAS to measure PM value.
It's completely different because here you can extract the structure.
Yes.
And this is more interesting.
No, and actually, there is something that we have not explored until now, that is the sensitivity to the NITAS to the structure of the neutron spectrum.
Yeah,
because for example, we have observed that in the case of the 95 rubidium, there are two different neutron intensities for the neutron spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
One is coming from one measurement, and the other one is coming from another measurement.
Mm-hmm.
The one that is accepted now in the evaluation is something that doesn't match our measurement. But if we go to the previous measurement, it matches very well this. So we are kind of sensitive to this neutron intensity, but one thing is to be sensitive and the other thing is to be able to say something about this.
Yeah.
We just say that the other neutron intensity is not good for us.
Okay.
At some point, and actually it's something that we are still thinking, if we can implement some kind of deconvolution process also for the neutrons to extract the neutron intensity. But we are at the very beginning of all this business.
Yeah, this is very interesting. You are sensitive to all the windows.
Yes.
More questions? Comments? If not, we thank Victor.